this message, saying, Moses, my servant is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, thou and all this people, unto the land which I do give to thee, even to the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given unto you, as I said unto Moses. From the wilderness and this Lebanon, even unto the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, and unto the great sea toward the going down of the sun, shall be your coast. There shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. I will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. He says in verse 6, be strong and of a good courage. For unto this people shall thou divide for an inheritance of the land, which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that has been therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest. Then Joshua commanded the officers of the people, saying, pass through the host, and command the people, saying, prepare your victuals, for within 3 days you shall pass over this Jordan, to go in to possess the land which the Lord your God giveth you to possess it. And to the Reubenites, and to the Gadites, and to the half-tribe of Manasseh, spake Joshua, saying, remember the word which Moses, servant of the Lord, commanded you, saying, the Lord your God hath given you rest, and hath given you this land. Your wives, your little ones, and your cows shall remain in the land which Moses gave you on this side, Jordan. But you shall pass before your brethren armed, all the mighty men of valor, and help them until the Lord have given your brethren rest, as he hath given you, and they also shall have possessed the land which the Lord your God giveth them. Then ye shall return unto the land of your possession and enjoy it, which Moses, the Lord's servant, gave you on this side of Jordan toward the sunrise. And they answered Joshua, saying, all that thou commandest us we will do, and whithersoever thou sendest us we will go, according as we hearken unto Moses in all things, so we hearken unto thee. Only the Lord thy God will be with thee as he was with Moses. Whosoever he be that doth prevail against thy commandment and will not hearken to thy words in all that thou commandest him, he shall be put to death. Only be strong and of a good courage. Moses, the great leader, the great man of God, was gone. In his stead stood Joshua. It was now incumbent upon Joshua to lead the children of Israel across Jordan to the promised land. And the Lord spake to Joshua, and he encouraged him. He admonished him to be strong and of a good courage. This was a very, very delicate time for Israel. As you remember, all that they had gone through, they had come out of Egyptian bondage. After this nation had been in Egyptian bondage for 430 years. They come out of Egyptian bondage. They have seen the mighty hand of God, and under the mighty hand of God, they had been released from the bondage that was placed upon them by the Egyptians and Pharaoh. The plagues came, the 10 plagues came, and they witnessed these things, and then finally Pharaoh said, get away from me. And they are allowed to leave, to go to this place promised to Abram many years before. And they get to the Red Sea, and mountains to the right of them, mountains to the left of them, the sea in front of them, and the armies of Pharaoh bowing down from the rear. And God, through his man Moses, he parted the Red Sea, and they went across on dry land. Some may even say it was a little dusty. And they go through the wilderness and they encounter different individuals and different nations, and they are victorious over them because God is leading the charge. And then finally they come to the Jordan. And Moses, God allowed him to look over and see the promised land as he had promised Moses. But because of Moses' disobedience, he was not allowed to cross over. So this was left to Joshua to lead the people into the promised land, across the River Jordan. But it was not just going to be as simple as crossing the Jordan and occupying this promised land. There was still work to be done. There were still battles to be fought. There were still victories to be won. And God takes this time to encourage Joshua, and he have him to in turn encourage the people to be strong and of a good courage. You see, I can't help you if I am afraid and fearful. I have to possess a certain amount of courage, and that courage has to be originate from God himself. The courage and the strength that we are able to encourage and strengthen one another with, it must come from God, from any other source. It's not going to be effective. So he encourages him. He tells him to be strong and of a good courage. This word strong to Zach, it means to take hold. For those of you who like to take notes, this word means to take hold, to be firm, to be impenetrable like a rock. So he says here, you be strong, you be firm, you take hold, you be impenetrable, because this is what impenetrable, because this is what's going to be needed in the days ahead. Amen. And remember, if you don't have this, then you can't give it to somebody else.
That's right.
You can't be the example that you need to be. So he tells Joshua to be strong and of a good courage. And then he talks about this word courage. This word courage, a mess. This word is the quality of mind. You need to get this now. This word courage is the quality, that quality of mind which enables men and women to encounter danger, to encounter difficulties with firmness, or without fear or depression of spirit. It involves valor, boldness, resolve or resolution, a willingness to take action. The difference between two people standing on the bank and one of them jumping into the water to help the person who's drowning and struggling, and the other one deciding not to. One had a willingness to take action. Not saying that the other person didn't have courage, but courage involves more. It involves a willingness to take action. Joshua reminded the Reubenites and the Gadites and the tribe of Manasseh. He said, you have taken possession of yours, but your brethren are going to need some help. He said, I want you to be there to help them. Mm-hmm. And through God, he tells Joshua, have to be strong and of a good courage, because you can't help them if you can't help yourself.
Well.
You have to remember, this was a very, very delicate time for Israel. It was not all over with yet. All the fighting, all the battles, all the conflicts had not yet come to an end. I'll venture to say they were just starting. So this was a very delicate time, and the man of God needed to be reminded by God to be strong and of a good courage. He tells him you have to be firm. You have to take hold. You have to be impenetrable, like a rock. You can't do anything for the person sitting to your left or sitting to your right unless you are strong.
Right.
We'll talk about that in a minute. This applies to us. You can't help the person to your left or to your right if you don't have the courage, the willingness to take action. Notice three times God said to Joshua, be strong and of a good courage. For God to say this three times, all it takes is one time for God to say something for it to be important. Amen. But God said this to Joshua three times, to be strong and of a good courage. Joshua spoke to Israel. If you don't mind, can I say Joshua spoke to the church? He talked to the church, amen, Israel,
amen,
about the need to be there, one for another.
Well,
I'm not going to hold you up this morning, but I just want to share this with you. It's important that you have courage in your daily walk as a child of God.
Amen.
If you have the courage and the strength that you need on your daily walk with God, it's going to make the fight against your enemies that much easier. If you don't mind looking at Joshua chapter 1, excuse me, Joshua chapter 2, beginning at verse number 1 as I close here. Joshua chapter 2, beginning at verse number 1, it says, and Joshua the son of Nun sent two men to spy secretly, said, go view the land, even Jericho. And they went and came unto his harlot's house, named Rahab, and lodged there. And it was told the king of Jericho, saying, behold, there came men in here tonight of the children of Israel to search out the country. And the king of Jericho sent unto Rahab, saying, bring forth the men that are come to thee, which are entered into thine house, for they be come to search out all the country. And the woman took the two men and hid them, and said thus, there came men unto me, but I wist not when they were. And it came to pass about the time to shut the gate when it was dark, that the men went out. Whether the men went out, I wot not. Pursue after them quickly, for you shall overtake them. But she had brought them up to the roof of the house and hid them with the stalks of flax, which she had laid in order upon the roof. And the men pursued after them the way to Jordan unto the forest. And as soon as they which pursued after them were gone out, they shut the gate. And before they were laid down, she came up unto them upon the roof. She hid these men out. She convinced the pursuers that they have left and gone outside the gate, so they pursue them. However, she has hid them out. In verse 9 it says, and she said unto them, I know that the Lord has given you the land, and that your terror, notice this, is fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land faint. Notice those words, terror is fallen upon us. All the inhabitants of the land faint because of you. Who are they in terror of? Who are they fainting because? They're talking about the children of Israel. They're talking about the church. Amen. They're talking about the children of God. In verse 10 it says, but we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did unto the two kings of the Amorites that were on the other side of Jordan, Sidon and Og, whom you utterly destroyed. And as soon, watch this, as we heard these things, our hearts did melt. Now these were people who are the enemies of God. And after they heard about the courage and the strong conviction of God's people, it caused their hearts to melt. It says, neither did there remain any more courage. You see, if you have courage from the Lord, you can just sap, sop, amen. Some of y'all grew up in the country, breakfast, amen. You get those biscuits, amen, and you get that warm syrup, and put that butter in there, and Brother Hubbard, you get that biscuit, amen. And you start out eating a little farther, amen. By the time it starts getting real good to you, you come down to the end, they say, look at that boy, that's softening up, amen. He's getting rid of it. He's taking says, neither did there remain any more courage in any man because of you. Why? For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven, above, and in earth. Listen, if you are a child of God and you show forth the strength that should be in you and the courage that should be in you, your enemy will kneel before you. You will simply take all their will to do you harm. But it requires courage. You have to be firm. You have to have a willingness to act. You have to be willing to act. They tell me talk is cheap. Anybody can talk about being a Christian.
That's right.
I'm not impressed. Live the life. Live the life. Before God and before men. In order to do that, it takes strength and it takes courage. Let me close with this. So Joshua talked to the church. God talked to Joshua, gave Joshua words of encouragement, told him it's going to start with you, Joshua. It's going to start with the leadership. You have to be strong. You, Joshua, have to have good courage. And then you can encourage those around you. When the people of God get on the march, as you saw in Joshua chapter 2, when the people of God are strong and courageous, and when they get on the march, the enemy will back off. You know why the world is in the predicament it's in now? With all the rot gun and everything else that's going on? Because the children of God did not stand up and act courageously. Did not stand up and act courageously. Let me show something with you. Some of you have heard before. During the time of World War II when they were sending people to the concentration camps, they were saying that right behind this little church building, there was railroad tracks. Every time the train would come by, the people in the building sing loud. Every time the train would come by, they would sing loud. Every time the train would come by, they would sing loud. But do you not know who's on those trains? The people being sent off to concentration camps. People who were being gassed and having different experiments, well, on them, men, women, children. Suppose the church, instead of just singing loud, they would show some kind of courage. Suppose they would have just stood on the track, or stood by the track, opposed to just singing loud. Courage requires a willingness to act.
Amen.
The right gut that we're dealing with in the world on a daily basis, the things that have been literally shoved down our throats on a daily basis because the church and people in the church did not stand up. Be strong and be courageous. And now we're at a time we've got to fight even harder, amen. We have to be strong. We have to be courageous. It's up to us. We shouldn't have to beg and pray. Let's just give me, amen. All of us can pray, amen. There are things we can do. The way we live our lives as a child of God. If just each one of us make a difference in the life of somebody else by the way we live our life as a child of God, but it's going to take strength and it's going to take courage. I can't do for you if I don't have the strength I need from God and the courage that I need from God. I can't do for you. You can't do for the person to your left or to your right if you don't have the strength and the courage that can only come from God. Joshua spoke to the church. He told the Reubenites, the Gadites, and the entire Manasseh, he said, you go ahead of your brother. You do whatever you got to do, and you help them to fight. You be courageous. You help them to fight. And Paul spoke to the church in Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. As I close here, Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. Paul says, brother, if a man be overtaken in a fault, you which are spiritual. Mm-hmm. Restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering yourself, lest thou also be tempted. Paul says, you which are spiritual, or you who are spiritual, the necessary inference here is that he's talking about somebody who is strong, amen, spiritually, who has spiritual courage, who can help this person out. Those who are spiritual, we have a responsibility, amen. Those who are spiritually strong, we have a responsibility to help those who are spiritually weak. And Paul goes on to say in verse 2, bear you one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. What's it going to take? We have to be strong. But we can't be strong. We can't be what we need to be if we're not doing what we need to do. I just want to remain physically strong. How does one remain mentally strong? It requires the right intake. Amen. It requires the right diet. You're not going to win a Mr. Universe contest eating nothing but donuts. Amen. I'm not saying anything wrong with donuts, but just like donuts too. Amen. But to be at your best, you have to have the right intake, the right balance. And when it comes to being strong as a child of God, without God's word, without ingesting, without taking in the word of God, we will not be where we need to be. I can't help myself if I'm spiritually weak. So guess what? I surely can't help you. We have to be strong. We have to be courageous, that we're going to be able to help our brethren, be able to help those that we say that we love and are concerned about. Paul spoke about what it would take to get to heaven, and this involves courage. Philippians chapter 3, verse 1, as I close here. Philippians chapter 3, verse 1. He says, finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you, to me, is indeed not grievous, but for you it is safe. He said, beware of dogs, beware of evil workers, beware of the circumcision. For we are the circumcision which worship God in the spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh. So what we're talking about here is spiritual things. And let me say this for the 19th time, amen. I'm going to keep on saying it. When we get the spiritual right, when we get the spiritual right, and I encourage us to invest more in the spiritual than we do in the carnal, in the physical, in the world, because it doesn't matter what kind of physical shape you are in, it is appointed unto man once to die, not this judgment. So when we get the spiritual right, when we are spiritually strong, when we are spiritually courageous, he says in verse 4, though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man think that he have wealth, he might trust in the flesh, I more. He says, circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel, the tribe of Benjamin, and Hebrew of the Hebrews, as touching the law, a Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteous which is in the law, blameless. But what things were gained to me, those I counted lost for Christ. They doubtless, and I count all things but lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things. Paul says, I want you to know where I was and where I am. Paul says, it required loss. It required giving up some things that I truly thought were important to me. And listen, once we become spiritually strong and have spiritually courageous, then we'll understand that we're going to lose some things. We have to sacrifice some things, and it may be people in our lives that we can no longer hang out with, amen. Things we can no longer read, things we can no longer watch, places we can no longer go, amen. Why? Because we're not strong enough spiritually. We have to sacrifice some things, put some things away from us, be willing to give up some things. Paul says, I gave up some things, and I counted it all lost that I made me in Christ. And be found in him, having not mine on own righteousness, Paul's this thing was way bigger than me. Because Paul thought that what he was doing was right at the time, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and fellowship, his suffering being made conformant unto his death. And watch verse 11. He says, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead, Paul said, here's what I'm seeking out of. Not as if I had all been attained, either were all made perfect, but I follow after, that if I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended for Christ. He says, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things that were behind, that are behind, and reaching forth into those things which are before. Paul says, I'm reaching for the prize. And that's why it takes strength and courage to press on. God told the children of Israel when they go out to battle, he says, those men that are weak and faint-hearted, you should lead them back. Because all it takes in the battle is for one person. All it takes is one. He said, they're weak and faint-hearted, you just leave them back. It's better to just leave them back. He said, you take those who are courageous, take those who are up for the fight. Paul says, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. The strength and courage to press on. That's what we have to have. That's what we need to be, brothers and sisters. If we're going to make heaven our home, if we're going to help somebody along the way, we have to have the strength and courage to press on. And that gives the idea of running the race and stretching out to cross that finish line. Amen? Not giving up. Having the strength and the courage. And three things. Encourage, exhort, and edify one another. You have to encourage, exhort, and edify. One more time. Encourage, exhort, and edify. And encourage or exhort means to come along the side and to call out to you. And sometimes it may be necessary to step back and give them a little push. Help you make it. Listen, I'm done. It takes as much strength and courage to do what's right as it takes to not do what's wrong. It takes a lot of strength and courage to do what's right. And it takes a lot of strength and courage to not do what's wrong. I encourage us this morning that we have the strength and courage to press on. And Jesus said to his disciples at one time, he says, when thou art converted, then you can strengthen your brother. I want us to get to the point where we are strengthened so that we can encourage others. So we can encourage others. Those who we love, those who we serve God, when we are strengthened, then and only then we'll be able to encourage them. It takes strength and courage to press on. Brothers and sisters, don't give up. If you're here this morning and you're not a child of God, now's the time. Today is the day of salvation. Today that you hear his voice calling out your heart. Now is the acceptable time. If you're here this morning and you're not a child of God, child of God by being obedient to the gospel of Christ. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, for God so loved the world that he gave his only God's Son. He died on the cross of Calvary, he was buried, and he rose again the third day. What is that, preacher? That's the gospel of Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 15:1-4. Those are the facts of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's what it's going to take in order to save man from his sin. None of this foolishness and none of this stuff in the world is going to save anybody.
Amen.
It's not going to save anybody. You have to go to God's word, where it lays out the preaching and the teaching of the gospel of Christ. Paul says in Romans 16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation. To everyone that believes, to the Jew first, also to the Greek. The gospel of Jesus Christ. The gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what it's going to take. If you're here this morning, you're not a child of God, you have to obey the gospel. How do you do that preaching? Well, you heard it. Do you believe it? Are you willing to have a change of mind? It's called repentance. Are you willing to confess that he was the Son of God? He said, if you confess me before men, I will confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me before men, I will deny night before my Father was in heaven. Blessed be his Son of God, go to the water of great baptism, have your sins washed away, rise to walk in this life, and add to the church of Christ, and the body of Christ, and says, bride is his wife, he's coming back for her. And then be faithful unto death, he says, I give you a crown of life. And we can teach you what God's word has to offer. And it will help you be strong and courageous and give you the will to press on. If you hear this morning, you're not a child of God, the invitation is yours. If you hear this morning, a child of God is falling by the wayside, for whatever reason, it does not matter. Come back home this morning. You need to take the opportunity to thank him. You need prayer for yourself or someone else, whatever situation you're dealing with, make it known as we stand and sing the song to encourage you this morning. We come.